listening to Pink Lady Presents, only on LA Talk Radio.
I'm gonna live till I die. I'm gonna laugh instead of cry. I'm gonna take the town and turn it upside down. I'm gonna live, live, live until I die.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Pink Lady Presents It Ain't Over Till You Say It's Over, a show filled with lives well lived. The gentleman standing here beside me is Bill Havis. Hi, Bill.
Hi, how you doing?
I'm doing fabulous. Good. And Bill, looking good and trim. How do you keep that body so good?
Oh, well, I try to cut down on my mustard chili and meatballs.
I get it. Well, Bill is a singer, a gentleman that Dove and I were out at a great place, a cantina, one evening. And we heard a group of people that were absolutely fabulous called the Randy Van Horn Singers. And Bill was one of them. And let me tell you, they are all extraordinary people. They just are. In fact, they're going to be singing at one time or another at Dove's El Los Angeles National Cemetery. And that will be a big hit for all of us. We can't wait to have them on. So, Bill, you were born in Chicago.
Yes.
And how many years ago was that?
It was 80.
80. Well, 80, a child. I mean, you know what I mean. I say that to my audience because I'm 86, going into my 87th year.
Wow.
So you're a mere child.
Good for you. Well, I'm getting close.
You're getting close.
I'll be 81 next month.
Oh, well, hello. I love it. So, you joined the Army. How young were you?
Well, back in the day, I wanted to go in the military, but I was too young, and I tried to join the Army in, back in 1952.
You were what, about 16?
Yeah, so they caught me and booted me out. So as soon as I was 17, I went and I enlisted in the Air Force.
Wow, hey.
So, and
how long were you in the Air Force?
I was on active duty for 4 years. And after I got out, I stayed in the reserves for another 30 years.
Oh, that's all. Thank you so much for your service, a long service.
My pleasure.
That's fabulous. I think our audience is ready for a warm-up. So how about a song from Bill Havis?
Sure. What are you doing the rest of your life? North and south and east and west of your life. I have only one request of your life, that you spend it all with me. All the seasons and the times of your days, all the nickels and the dimes of your days, let the reasons and the rhymes of your days all begin and end with me. I want to see your face in every kind of light, in fields of dawn and forests of the night. And when you stand before the candles on a cake, oh, let me be the one to hear the silent wish you made. Those tomorrows waiting deep in your eyes, in the world of love you keep in your eyes, I'll awaken what's asleep in your eyes. It may take a kiss or two through all of my life, summer, winter, spring, and fall of my life. All I ever will recall of my life is all of my life with you. Thank you.
Yeah, sit down. We can talk a little while, and then I'm going to get you right up again.
Let me have the mic backwards.
Yeah, because I know my audience. He's going to sing again.
Okay.
When you were service for 30 years and stuff, that was reserve, am I correct?
Yes.
Okay. And then, but where did the Chicago police officer come in?
Oh.
I mean, that's interesting now.
Well, after I got out of the Air Force, I went back to Chicago,
right,
my hometown, and I joined up with the police department.
Oh.
And
I mean, Bill, it sounds like it's easy, ladies and gentlemen. I don't think so. You just don't join. You got to go through this
whole thing.
Yeah.
I did the whole thing, you know. I finally went through the Chicago Police Academy and went out on the street for a couple of years.
Oh, boy. Okay.
And the 10 below zero
just wasn't
my cup of tea. So,
no.
Yeah, my kids were always had runny noses and getting cold. So I had some friends who lived in California, and they would send me paper clippings.
90 degrees in December.
Yeah, really.
80, right.
Send me paper clippings from the L.A. Times.
Uh-huh.
And there were ads for policemen.
Oh.
And you know that they were paying $641 a month.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. And, what were you getting in where you were?
About $430.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
And we had to buy all our own stuff.
Oh, you're kidding me.
Uniforms, guns, leather, the whole shot.
Oh, my. Thank you for your service in the police department. Now buy your stuff.
Thank you.
Well, I didn't realize that.
Yeah, and then, so I said, well, that's it. I'm going west.
And that's what you did.
Yeah, I picked up the family and the kids and the dog.
Now, how many children do you have?
I have three. I have three boys.
Wow.
And
a dog.
And a dog.
And wait a minute, what about the wife?
Well, the wife, yes, the wife came along too.
Okay. I mean, we have a dog and three kids. We're going to have the wife in there. So when did you come out? What year did you come out here?
I think it was 1962.
Okay.
And I went to work right away at Lockheed.
Oh, all right.
And while I was waiting for my call for the
police,
the LAPD.
Right.
Yeah, I worked there for a few years, and then I did get the call.
And?
I went to the LA Police Academy, graduated, went out, and I worked for them for 20 years.
Oh, my goodness. Okay.
And
and what, we a street cop or
yes.
In the car and yeah, all that stuff?
Yeah, the first 15, next 10, I was a detective.
Oh, wow.
In Hollywood.
That must have been interesting,
yeah,
especially in Hollywood.
You know, what's really fascinating is we had a guest, Major General Peter Gravett, who was with, after his military service as a Major General, joined LAPD for another 20 years.
I'll be darned.
Yes. So, and he was sitting in that seat.
I love it.
Wow.
And so you spent how many years again in the LAPD then?
20 years.
20 years.
A couple of years in Chicago, and then when I retired, I didn't know what to do with myself, so.
So you started to sing.
I did.
I know.
It was just a fluke, you know. A friend of mine who was, we were church members. And,
right.
He was selling tickets one night for his show, and I asked him about it, and he said, yeah, come and see us. And it was the San Fernando Valley Male Chorus.
Very good. Great group.
Yeah.
Great group.
And so I did that. I went and auditioned. They took me in, and I sang with them for about 7 years.
Wow. And how long have you been with the Randy Van Horn Singers?
For about the same amount of time, I think.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Love it. Well, can you pleasure us, please, and give us another song?
Certainly.
Certainly, yeah. Let me push this back and help you out and push that there.
You know, in your last show, We Are America, you had a number of people volunteer as ushers from the chorus from San Fernando Valley.
They were all really great, at the Madrid Theater.
Super.
Okay.
What is America to me? A name, a map, or a flag I see? A certain word, democracy. What is America to me? The house I live in, a plot of earth, a street, the grocer and the butcher, and the people that I meet, the children in the playground, the faces that I see, all races, all religions, that's America to me. The place I work in, the worker at my side, the little town or city where my people lived and died, the howdy and the handshake, the air of feeling free, and the right to speak my mind out, that's America to me. The things I see about me, the big things and the small, the little corner newsstand and the house a mile tall, the wedding and the churchyard, the laughter and the tears, and the rule that's been a-growing for over 200 years. The town I live in, the street, the house, the room, the pavement of the city, or a garden all in bloom, the church, the school, the clubhouse, the million lights I see, but especially the people, that's America to me.
Yes, yes. My dear friends out there, Bill Havis, 8 grandchildren.
It's Havis.
Havis. Oh, just say it loud and clear. Bill Havis. I just changed your name back again. Bill Havis. 8 grandchildren, 5 great-grandchildren. May we be here for another 100 years. May you continue your fabulous singing with them and the chorus of Randy Van Horn singers, as well as the San Fernando Valley male chorus. And may you have blessed years.
And before we leave, I just want to let our audience know, if you send an email to Pink Lady Presents, you have to come to this show, you've seen the email and the website. We will be happy to refer that information and inquiry to Lynn Keller and the Randy Van Horn singers.
Right.
They're marvelous musicians. They're really terrific. And we're very pleased that they appear at the LA National Cemetery. And you can always see them throughout the year at the Viva Cantina.
Right.
Great show, great musicians. Thank you for watching.
Thank you. We'll be right back.
I believe it is not the breaths we take in life that count. It's what we do with the breaths we take. And I should know, 84 years young. Today on this stage, you will see talented performers all over the age of 60.
It's only a cabaret. Oh, chum.
Money. You got lots of friends hanging around that door.
I'm gonna live and live now, 'cause everything's
when your fingers touched my silent heart and taught it how to sing.
Dear, with your lips to mine, of rhapsody divine, zing went the strings of my heart.
To reach the unreachable, the unreachable stars.
But I've got to do it all in 3 minutes or less. How about maybe ragtime? How about boogie woogie?
Woo! Darling, let's dance. Let the music take us. The blues ain't gonna break us. We won't give it no chance.
Just that old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind.
You've treated me so.
Got it.
We're back. I never know when we're back. Of the first show, the second show, it's like, hello. Oh, we're back again. I have to tell you, my friend here, my engineer, she waves a flag, an American flag, at me. I'm going, oh, that's so sweet of her. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, no, I have to begin. Hello, everyone. We're back. I normally say certain things when I introduce a life well lived. Today, it's going to be a little different, okay? You all see this handsome gentleman sitting beside me. There is a gentleman out there, Master Sergeant Vernon McDonald, Army 9th Cavalry, World War II, Buffalo soldier. His son, Bobby, is sitting beside me now, and I know that Vernon is proud. Bobby is proud that his dad is proud, and Dove and I are proud that you're sitting here with us. So, beginning here, I'm just like thrilled. You have no idea. First of all, because the Buffalo Soldiers, to me, not knowing anything about them before I started going with Chaplain Dove, and learning about them as time went on these past 5 years, to me, is such a thrill having you here, because you're going to tell my phenomenal audience out there, what about the Buffalo Soldier? Who was he? What was he? What did he stand for in our country?
Well, I happen to have been very, very fortunate to live with one.
I know. I got to meet Vernon. I love you, but I got to meet that man.
It had its ups, it had its downs, it had its moments.
I get it.
But it didn't come about what we were doing or how we were doing or how we were growing up until a little later on.
Like anything else,
right. you learn. What's the old army saying? The son goes off to war and he comes back and he tells his old man, he says, "Hey, it's amazing what you've learned the last
three years.
But let me go back a little bit.
Please,
you know,
please,
when you look at our family. It's been military all the way.
Okay.
And when I say that, my mother is and my mother's side of the family were Vavasors. They were French. They were Creole from Louisiana.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. My dad was born in Chicago, grew up and was raised here in Los Angeles. But when World War II came along, he wound up joining the service over at Fort MacArthur.
How old was he at that time?
Probably in his 20s, because he's 94 now.
God bless him.
Okay. You know, and so he got transferred over to Louisiana, to Camp Claiborne, a camp that was named after the first governor of Louisiana, and most people don't know this part of history either, but that's where the 82nd and 101st Airborne was founded in Camp Claiborne, Louisiana.
Okay, did not know that. Yeah.
So anyway, while he had a friend named August Bajois that he had met, and he was from Lafayette, Louisiana. Okay. And so on leave one day, they went down to from Alexandria. That's where Camp Claiborne right. pretty much is in this locale. But they went down to Louisiana, and I guess one of his favorite songs is "I Met a Million Dollar Baby in a 5 and 10 cent Store," because he met my mom in a Cress, okay, a Cressy or a Newberry's, one of them, okay,
right.
yeah. But that was a story.
Okay.
It got a little deeper later on because I then found out when we had the Buffalo Soldier reunion, fast forward to 2002, right. I found out I went home one day and I told him, I said, wow, did you know that we had a Buffalo, we had a prison of war camp in San Diego?
Oh.
The Buffalo Soldiers patrolled the border doing San Diego at Camp Lockett.
Oh,
down,
wow.
Down
did not know that.
During World War II. Well, there was a rumor
okay.
that the Japanese and the German were going to come up, Germans were going to come up through Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. they put the Buffalo Soldiers on the border. No walls, no nothing. Just,
just you know, them.
And if you get down there, you'll take a look and you'll see that... this side of California looks just like that side of Mexico.
And this is long before,
yeah.
for those who really aren't aware,
yeah.
there was no integration in oh, no. the military.
Oh, no, no, no. That was segregated. The 9th and the 10th Cavalry, 24th and 25th Infantry right. were segregated.
Are you listening to this? Because yes. this is history.
Totally, yes. totally
right.
segregated.
Right.
Now, let me go back
go
to the old days. So as my father and my mother got together and stuff to that effect, and I've done my history. As I said, my dad's maternal grandfather, my paternal grandfather and great grandfather,
right?
Okay, were both born in Kingston, Jamaica.
Oh,
so
wow.
my dad's paternal dad is my dad's father and grandfather.
Right.
Yeah, so
from
mine
Jamaica.
From Jamaica.
Wow.
From Kingston, Jamaica.
Oh my goodness.
All right. So and they were sailors. Okay, they were sailors, and they came over to Louisiana and all that kind of stuff. So anyway, when I got to my mother's side and started doing some research,
yeah.
and I looked at it, and I got the rolls of the Louisiana militia during the War of 1812.
On her side?
On her side.
Wow.
There are two vavasors listed.
No
on
way.
The rolls of
oh
the
oh my
yeah.
lord.
Okay. So and I didn't get a chance to check some of the other family names, but I just looked for the Vavasors and I'm going, whoa.
Wow.
So we go all the way back to the War of 1812.
Oh my goodness.
Okay.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. from there.
Yeah. So anyway, I'll fast forward back to that
no,
story.
Don't fast. I love it.
Okay, well I'm gonna fast forward back to that story because okay. I grew up and Dad never talked about the war. Never talked
really?
About the service. No. And so when I went home and I said, hey, Pop, guess what? You realize that we had a prisoner of war camp in San Diego and Camp Lockett? And he said, well, we had one in Camp Claiborne, Louisiana. And I watched his face drop. All right?
Wow.
And at least in our family, when the face dropped, okay, going to bed, with no dinner, you're going to get a whooping or a combination thereof. You know, and I'm a little old, so I do like that. I said, whoa, I'm too old for this. Yeah.
yeah.
And then, I mean, but now I saw it. And just, and that was 2002.
Oh,
now,
boy.
Keep in mind, I had to be, what, almost early 50s, late 50s,
right,
whatever.
Right.
And I'm just now hearing this. So now I'm just hearing more and more of these stories.
Oh,
and it's unbelievable. I mean, it's, whew.
Bobby, let yeah. me ask you, why, because I know why now that these men coming back from Afghanistan and the people that were in the Vietnam Wars
yeah.
and stuff like that, what from Dove was telling me, they don't want to talk about it.
Well,
why do you think your dad didn't want to talk about it?
Well, I can tell you why
time.
My dad didn't
okay.
talk about
like,
it.
Why?
I can flat out tell you. By doing that research, I also found I was looking for my dad's stuff
right.
on the internet
right.
Because they had that big fire where they lost all the records. The Army lost a lot of its records.
Oh, no.
Oh, yeah.
God.
Well,
really?
Yeah, but unfortunately, we're getting there, okay? We're getting there. Yeah, the Department of Defense has records.
Yeah.
The VA has records, but they haven't mind mailed them yet, okay?
They didn't know they wanted
yeah,
right. integrate but them. Hello.
But, well, you know, information highway, right?
Right.
But anyway, they're working on it right now, okay? So I'm looking and I find five uncles that were
oh.
all doing the Buffalo Soldiers
no way.
During World War II. And
oh.
they were all, but the thing is, when Daddy told me that there were a prisoner of war camp there at Camp Claiborne, And then I understood what was going on because the light went on. German soldiers were allowed to go off the base anytime they wanted to, but the black soldiers couldn't.
Really?
Oh, wow.
Oh, my
Lord. Some of those things that happened to me while I was growing up, now I know why.
Wow, yes. Okay. Yeah.
So, you know, it's a good time because I could talk about it, and I feel good at talking about it because people don't understand that part of the history.
No, they don't. We have a picture I think they're going to show of your dad and yourself and some of the Buffalo soldiers. They're just showing a shot now. Sure. I mean, I can't believe it.
The picture they're showing now, if this is the one I sent you the other night.
The Disney one?
The Disneyland.
Yes,
one of me and my father, yes. And then one with the other guys.
Correct. Right.
Okay. Right. As I shared with you earlier, that you know, I chair the Black Chamber of Commerce. I'm the president and executive director of the Black Chamber of Commerce in Orange County.
That's another thing that my friend here does side.
Yeah, in my free time. Yeah, my day job, my free time. But with my relationship with Disneyland, there's a group called Salute.
Okay.
And Salute is the veterans group that's inside Disney that works with different entities.
Did you know that? Mm-hmm.
Nick Philippone and Mark Saunders, God bless both of them. I went to them and I said, hey, guys, it's the 150th anniversary of the Buffalo Soldiers. And I said, we need to do something for our Buffalo Soldiers. So what they did was Disneyland every day has a flag lowering ceremony. So they'll bring the band out and the singers, and they'll lower the flag.
Oh.
And they'll play the national anthem and stuff. And what they'll do is then they'll play a set of songs that are all the medley of military songs. And then those individuals that are around the flag, so the flagpole, they'll stiff their Army, the Marines, the Navy, the Air Force, Coast Guard, and they'll all stand and salute and stuff.
Oh.
So what they did was they had a special presentation just for the Buffalo Soldiers. And it was nice to have my dad, and I believe in the picture is Trooper Jones, and Trooper Jones is there because his dad is the one that got me. It's on the picture.
Yeah, I was looking at some of the names and stuff.
Trooper Jones was the one, his dad, Fred Jones, is the one that got me involved with the Buffalo Soldiers, before I even knew my dad was a Buffalo Soldier.
Oh, my Lord.
So, I mean, it came, and Trooper Jones and I are the only two members in the greater Los Angeles area chapter that are descended. There's three ways you can be a Buffalo Soldier.
Okay.
Spiritual, raise your hand, I want to be a Buffalo Soldier. Right. Second way is to be a descendant of. And then the real deal. And I'm in the middle.
Yeah, you are.
Yeah.
Wow.
But Colonel Henderson is in the picture. They're off to the right next to me. Mm-hmm. And you got Trooper Dennis and then Trooper Aaron. Trooper Aaron was in the Korea, and then Trooper Dennis next to Ron there was in World War II.
How?
And he was stationed at Camp Claiborne. Stationed down at San Diego, Camp Lockett.
How long did the separation go? The Buffalo Soldiers were, segregated, okay? But how long did it go?
All black soldiers were segregated. As a matter of fact, General Gravitt told us a story when he was here, that when he took command of a unit that was north of L.A., all of the black soldiers had to be on that side of the highway and all the white soldiers on the ocean side, except the commander's residence was on the ocean side, and he was the commander.
Yeah.
So he moved in on the ocean side, and he said, as people rotate into base, whenever they come here, they go to the next available bed. We don't have that segregation.
Yeah.
And he helped with that.
And when I asked Dad about Camp Claiborne, and when we started getting deeper into it, I mean, and it's one of those things where it comes in pieces. Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, it comes in pieces. And that's all right. I don't have a problem with that. But I took a trip to Louisiana. The Buffalo Soldiers had the reunion in Louisiana.
Oh.
So in New Orleans. So I drove from New Orleans all the way up to Camp Claiborne. And which is a good 2.5-3 hours.
Oh, wow.
But Louisiana, it's a big forest.
Yeah.
I mean, it's wonderful.
It's beautiful.
It is beautiful.
It is.
So anyway, I go in and I missed a turn, and so I wound up going into Alexandria, and I stopped at the American Legion because I'm a member, and I stopped in and I asked one of the guys sitting at the bar where it was, and I just missed it, so I had to go back down. So after I went through Camp Claiborne and found out that on their kiosk, they had a picture of Sergeant York had come by to take a look at the troops. Sergeant York's World and Medal of Honor recipient, right. God bless him, and wow. World War One. I mean, and I got the pictures historical, and then I called him on the right. way back down to New Orleans, and he's telling me about all these things. I said, why'd you tell me this in the first place? But it was just, it was great to find, and Camp Claiborne was so big. And then when you stop and think that he said, the train track, what they did at Camp Claiborne was set up to go over to Italy and to France, because they were ready to go and do all the construction and stuff to that. And they had to go over there, and my dad was an electrician, part of the construction group. And he says, you have the AC and DC current. They had to be prepared for both sides of the current to do the electricity, because the Germans, as they were retreating, were blowing up all the capacitors and all that stuff. But he was also saying that when you went down the middle of the camp,
right.
Or Camp Claiborne,
right.
was a train track, because they had to get ready with the trains and stuff to go over there. And he said, but the white troops were on one side and the black troops were on the other.
Unreal.
Yeah.
Unreal.
And I have one last story on that's clean.
Okay. A family show.
It's a family show. It's clean. But he would say that when they would come in off the trains, and again, that's right, all the black soldiers in the back and all that kind of stuff. But when they got off the train, and this is kind of one of the things that kind of irritated me. So when you got off the train, it was a $19 cab ride from Alexandria to Camp Claiborne.
Oh, boy.
Okay?
Yeah.
If you were, the white soldiers would get off and get in the cab, and it only cost them $19 as a group.
Right.
Black soldiers have to pay $19
each. I knew you were going to say that.
Yeah.
Son of a gun.
Yeah.
Unreal.
And then now I want to know why he had an attitude.
Hello.
Yeah.
I get the attitude. We would like to play right now it's 6 minutes, but it's 6 minutes that I think is going to be fascinating to our audience to see of the Buffalo Soldier video. So let's shoot that right now.
Civil War, the United States faced the need for a larger peacetime military to occupy the South and protect settlers on the Western frontier. In the summer of 1866, July 28th to be exact, the United States Congress passed legislation establishing a peacetime military. Before the legislation was passed, a hotly debated issue concerned the inclusion of African Americans in the regular army. Some politicians made the then radical suggestion that the Army fully integrate African Americans into its ranks. Other politicians wanted the Army to remain white only. They eventually agreed to maintain the status quo and continue placing African American recruits in segregated units. A provision of the 1866 legislation created 6 regiments of African American troops, 4 infantry and 2 cavalry of approximately 1,000 men each. In August 1866, the 9th and 10th Cavalries were organized. The 9th Cavalry was in Greenville, Louisiana, with most of the original recruits from nearby New Orleans, Louisiana, and Louisville, Kentucky. The 10th Cavalry was at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. Many of the recruits in both units were freed slaves from the North. The assigned mission of these African American troops was to escort the Native Americans from their indigenous homelands to designated reservations. The nickname Buffalo Soldier was bestowed on the troops by the Native Americans as a testament to their valor in battle. The buffalo was a sacred animal to the Native Americans, and they would not bestow its name on the soldiers unless they were worthy adversaries, fighting ferociously to the end and living up to their motto, "We can, we will, and ready and forward." The proud acceptance of the name Buffalo Soldier by the African-American soldiers was a badge of honor and pride for the troops. The Buffalo Soldiers were sent to the Great Plains along the Rio Grande, New Mexico, Texas, Arizona, Colorado, and into the Dakotas. The duties of the 9th and 10th U.S. Cavalries included guarding the mail, escorting and guarding stagecoaches, cattle drives, railroad crews, and surveyors. They built roads and telegraph lines. They mapped and explored, including mapping vast territories in Arizona and New Mexico, even marking watering holes. They played a major part in building the West and making it safe for the westward expansion. In July 1885, the 10th Cavalry moved west into Arizona. After arriving, troops of the regiment were dispersed throughout the area to cover as much territory as possible. These troops were stationed at Wilpo Barracks, Fort Grant, Fort Thomas, and Fort Apache. In 1913, the 10th Cavalry Buffalo Soldiers were sent to Fort Huachuca and remained there for almost 20 years. They joined General John J. Pershing in the 1916 expedition into Mexico. And during the World War I, they were assigned the mission of guarding the United States-Mexican border. Second Lieutenant Henry Ossian Flipper, a member of the 10th Cavalry, was the first African-American graduate of the U.S. Military Academy, West Point, class of 1877. Lieutenant Flipper excelled in engineering, law, French, and Spanish. After dismissal from the Army, Henry Ossian Flipper went on to obtain recognition and respect as a surveyor, and in 1890, he opened his own civil mining engineering office in Nogales, Arizona. Joseph S. Flipper II, the grandnephew of Henry Ossian Flipper, has lived in Phoenix since 1945. He has had a long and distinguished teaching career and is an active member of the Greater Southern Arizona Area Chapter of the 9th and 10th Horse Cavalry Association. In 1994, the Arizona Legislature passed and the governor signed House Joint Resolution 2001, designating a portion of State Route 90 as the Buffalo Soldier Trail. On July 25, 1992, General Colin Powell, then Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, dedicated the Buffalo Soldiers Monument at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, the birthplace of the 10th Cavalry Regiment. The monument stands as a well-deserved tribute to the soldiers for their continued excellence and contributions to this state and nation over the years. Despite prejudice, in and out of the military, and being allocated the worst horses, the worst clothing, and equipment, these outstanding individuals earned more Congressional Medals of Honor and had the lowest desertion rate of any unit in the Army. Fort Huachuca honors the legacy of the Buffalo Soldiers.
So tell me, when was this filmed, Bobby?
We had a Buffalo Soldier reunion. One of the annual reunions was down in Tucson, Arizona.
Right.
And so my buddy William Byers with Explorer Studios, I asked him, he's a filmmaker, and I said, come on, join the guys. Come on down with me. Let's go.
Right.
So we went down, and we went to Fort Huachuca, and we went to all these different places, and we saw the work that the state of Arizona did, and they named it in 2007 the Year of the Buffalo Soldier.
I love it.
So we took some of that material and stuff, and we decided put this film together. So, you know, people had bits and pieces of what the Buffalo Soldiers were and what they're doing, but no one did a complete video of start to finish, soup to nuts, and that's what we did here.
I know the audience loves it. I like, there's a banner that they're watching right now. The banner says, "We can, we will. Ready and forward, always prepared and onward." God bless them. I love it. By the way, before I do anything, because I want to get to it, you have something for my nice friend here.
I probably could find something.
Okay,
yeah.
Will you find something for Bobby?
So I wanted to share with our audience a couple of things. One is that We did our very first 55 African Union with the Consul Generals last March, and called Bobby and said, you know, could you bring, and I think you brought the immediate national past president, Mr. Henderson.
Yeah, Colonel Franklin Henderson, yes, sir.
Franklin Henderson, and you actually presented the ambassador to the United States from the 55 African nations with a Buffalo Soldier jacket.
That was myself, Ron Jones, and Trooper Ron Jones.
And she was very appreciative, and we're going to do a really big event in September 2019 with all 55 nations.
So and you know, she never took that jacket off, neither.
No,
she put it on, and the whole program she
wore. And it was a hot day. Yeah. She was a trooper.
Well, but she's from Africa.
This
was a cool day, yeah, right?
So that was number one. The second thing is I wanted our audience to know that within the L.A. National Cemetery, we have slightly over 100 Buffalo soldiers in eternal rest in Los Angeles. And the third thing is that as the president of the National Cemetery Support Foundation, I get the privilege, the honor of doing nice things for nice people. And we have just begun, first time in 100 years, we have a challenge coin. And those of you who have been in the military, you know that challenge coins are very, very popular. We've never had one, but we have one now, and I can't think of anyone more appropriate to present it to than Bobby McDonald, Buffalo Soldier and President of the Orange County Black Chamber of Commerce.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank
yes.
you for your thank service, you. And thank you. You for all of you do to educate, because you are a big part of history.
And we have another information. You have a siblings.
Well,
tell us
I've got
about
a,
your brother and sister.
Yeah, I've got a brother and a sister that had to live in the same house with me with this Buffalo
oh
soldier.
Boy.
Well,
oh
I was a master sergeant. You know, I knew all the things. You know, walk my post in a military manner and take no crap from this company commander and all that kind of stuff.
Okay.
But anyway, but we didn't know. We knew that we had to get our work done. We knew that we had if you had to be prepared,
yes.
Okay,
yes.
And Daddy made sure we were. But my brother, although I was in Vietnam, I fixed him. I didn't want to be in the Army. I went to the Navy. I fixed him. I went to Vietnam twice. But anyway, on the USS Tripoli. But while I was on the Tripoli in Vietnam, my brother had joined the Air Force. In 66, and he was wound up stationed in a little bit north of me in Okinawa.
Oh,
so
wow.
He was in the vicinity. All right,
oh,
so
yeah.
He was in the Vietnam era. My sister still hung around the house, and she became she's good at what she does. You know, so anyway, she's a good lady too, really good lady.
Oh, wow.
But my dad raised three good kids. Okay, and I'm saying I'm good. All right,
I'm going to go to one thing before our time runs out. There's a book cover that's going on the screen right now for our audience to see, the Black College Football book. Can you just give us a fast thing on that?
It's amazing because I tell people, it's funny how your life changes and things happen and you don't know what reasons for. I had a buddy of mine named Michael Hurd. And he knew that I was in the sporting goods business. I used to work for ProCads when I graduated from Cal State Fullerton, and I used to work for Adidas.
Ah,
all right, I used to work for Kids. You know those WK340s you wear when you're not wearing those
pretty
pink shoes, okay?
I love them.
But anyway, so we met in the press box of the Los Angeles Rams down in Orange County, because I used to work out in the PR department on game days. And he was telling me, he says, you know, my parents went to a black college, and I want to do a book on black colleges.
Oh, wow.
And I said, I just came back from Louisiana, where Coach Eddie Robinson from Grambling, who's the most winning in football coach there
correct.
Is. All right, you can all say about Joe Paterno what you want, but Coach Robinson's my man, okay? He's the one that did it the hard way. And so he went to school with my uncles down at Leland University, Bill and Owen Knox. And so when I wound up doing, he wanted me to come down. Some one of my cousins in New Orleans said, if you want some marketing done, call Bobby. So I flew to Grambling, because I got recruited by the best, to come down to Grambling, and he wanted to get his TV show. So I went down to start doing his TV show. to help him get it. Mark. So not only did I get his TV show going, I got him his first football contract, national football. His first shoe, national shoe contract. Got him a clothing contract. And, you know, and
will
and
you I be my manager?
So I did all that. Right. Now, going back to the book, when I was sitting with Michael up in the press box, right. And he says he wanted to do the book, and I said, you know, I need to do a book on Coach Orton's 50th anniversary. So we shook hands to do a black college football book. So our black college football book, Michael is the author of record. So if they went to Amazon to try to get a copy, it's Black College Football, 100 Years of History, Education, and Pride. You'll see me as writing the forward, and love when you it. Turn in, see the forward page, and me, and there I am.
And where can they get your book?
Well, probably we were out. We out of publish. I mean, we're out of print. So you have to go to Amazon and get a copy. Let me back up a second. Yeah. So anyway, we're doing this, and as I'm reading the book, because we kicked it off and unveiled it at the biggest sporting event you could ever have in Louisiana, which is the Bayou Classic, Grambling and Southern. You haven't lived until you've gone to a Bayou Classic, okay? So I'm reading the book on the plane back, right. And there's a section in the book that Michael starts off with. And it says, back in 1866, when the land grants had started, and all the churches were getting these schools started because they had the land grant money.
Right.
And the 62nd and 65th Colored Infantry pulled their resources together and came up with $5,000. Did I say $5,000?
Yeah.
And that's a lot of money
now. That's right.
To incorporate Lincoln University in Jefferson City, Missouri. So the Buffalo Soldiers back in 1866 knew the value of education.
I love it. You know what? I don't know where my time has gone. Every time we have someone really interesting on, time like flies. I want to thank you, Bobby McDonald. I want to thank Vernon for giving me a chance to meet his wonderful son. I know you're sitting there one day and you're going to watch this show and you're going to say, wow, that's my boy. Well, he's thinking the same thing and so am I. God bless you, Bobby McDonald. God bless the Buffalo Soldiers. Thank you for your service. I'm going to give you my book, which says, get up, get out, and get a life. You've already gotten up and gotten out and gotten a life. God bless you.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
God
appreciate
bless
it.
Everyone. And thank you for your
Thanks,
service.
Bobby.
Thank you so much. We'll see you next time.
Take care.
God bless you.
You're listening to Pink Lady Presents, only on LA Talk Radio.